Gentlemen, good morning. 6 minutes after the hour. Welcome back to Inside the News. I'm Josh. I'm here with John and Paul. And we've got on the phone with us from where he is at right now. It's Han Solo. And nobody knows where he's at. But we're glad you're here on the phone with us today. And we have been talking about some amazing stuff. We're about to get into how we can free ourselves from financial tyranny, which I can't wait to get into, but we've got to take a couple calls here, Han. You're with us now?
Yep, I'm here.
Excellent. We've got Jimmy Jedi from New Hampshire, who's got a question for Han Solo. And up next is Darth Vader. But go ahead.
How you guys doing?
Hey, thanks so much for calling, Jimmy. What do you got?
Well, I wanted to say that Han is absolutely right. We have the numbers backing us. All we have to do is get organized and get together, you know, to stop these people. That's pretty much it.
You know, I love your New Hampshire accent up there, Jimmy Jedi, and thanks for listening all the way up in New Hampshire here to K-Talk Radio. What are your comments to Jimmy Jedi, Han Solo?
Well, quite frankly, that was going to be the next thing that I was going to suggest, is the world is but a stage, and we are merely the players, as Shakespeare said, in the Globe Theatre. So stop playing the game. It's that simple. If we just stop playing the game, then we win.
But you can't do that as an individual.
Of course you can. Every time you get a tax form, send it back to them. I haven't paid taxes for years and years and years. I refuse to open anything from the IRS. I just send it back to them.
Well, you know,
go away.
Han Solo, I had a very good friend who did that, and he ended up with 5 years in the federal prison, and he tried to object to that. Really has to be a mass for everyone to do it
work. I'm with you on that, but I can't control what you do. I can only control what I do, and if I do it, you know, then it's your choice of what you do. So I've been doing it for years and years and years. I've got a collection. They send me like loads. It's really cute. And then I just write things on each different one. Like I just tell them I don't live here anymore. I tell them I give them to a different address. I send them to other people's houses. That's another fun one. Send them to another address. I don't live here. Just let them deal with that. You know, whoever's doing my case must have so much fun, because literally they are just like on this treasure hunt to find out which country I'm in and which house I'm in. You know, it's just like, well, you're not there this time. It's good fun.
Hey, Jimmy, thanks for listening, and thanks for calling in.
Not a problem. Great show, guys.
Hey, thanks. Don't be a stranger. All right, next up, we got Rob. Rob, go ahead.
Yeah, you know, that was a topic I called in about at 7 o'clock this morning. Is, you know, watching all these politicians, nobody's mentioning the national debt. And your caller, you got your guest there, I mean, spot on. I mean, it's basically discipline. It's discipline for each individual person in this country. You know, I watch these people watch all these football games year after year, and these football players are making millions and millions of dollars. And they go to the tailgate parties, and they pay all this enormous amount of money for these games and tickets and the local basketball stuff and everything else. And I just wonder, where do these people get the money and the time to do these things?
Well, most of them are in debt. I can explain the tailgate party, but actually sitting through the game, I don't know.
But I mean, it's just all these different things. I mean, buying new trucks and all, you know, you've got to have some discipline in your life. And, you know, you always need a place to rest your head. So when you say someone, you know, has to pay 30 years of their life being a slave to their home, they should really look at their budget on a monthly or an annual basis and see what they're spending their money on and take that money and start counting it towards their mortgage. And it, before you do, if you keep doing that, you know, you'd be surprised. It gets paid right off.
What I'm trying to say is, with respect to the mortgage, is that should we be working for 30 years for a home? I mean, back in the old days, I mean, of course, we have different technologies and stuff, but people just, you know, spend a couple weeks and build a house. But nowadays, we have to spend 30 years and hundreds of thousands of dollars for a home. And now we have to, I think this was the whole point of the women's rights movement, was to get women in the workplace so that they could steal their money, too.
Well, there's things that people don't look about when you go to build a house. Let's look at the start of a house. It's a building permit. You know, your building permit right now costs you $40,000, $50,000 on average just to build a house. And what is it? It's impact fees for the police, impact fees for the firefighters, city impact fees, all these things that we're being double taxed. And people don't even think about stuff like that or say anything about it. I mean, your firefighters are all standing around. When your house burns down, they're billing your insurance company to come out and put the fire out. And we're already paying for them to sit around.
Yep.
These are the things that no one mentions or talks about or gets upset about. So that's why your house is $50,000 more than it was 40 years ago, because you didn't have impact fees like we have on these building permits now. There's insanity, some of the things going on that we allow going on. And why? Because everyone's watching, worried about the New England Patriots and the Chicago Bears, or what's on, the American Idol. Everyone's sitting around, they got time to do that and watch all that stuff. Meanwhile, you're taking it in the backside. You got to think about it. But yeah, this is these debates. They talk about foreign affairs, and not one of these politicians said, "Listen, we shouldn't be worrying about foreign affairs right now. We got our own checkbook to balance here." And I keep saying that year after year.
How would you respond to the caller?
Well, first of all, I think he's 100% correct, but I'd go one level deeper than that. I was born on a mud ball flying through space. Who the hell tells me I've got to pay to live on it? That's what it's coming down to. I'm on this mud ball. I'm born on it, and now I've got to pay to build a house on it. Anywhere I go, I can't build a house because someone's going to yell at me because it's not up to code, it's not up to standard, it's not up to... I mean, think about how irrational that is from a standpoint of... as a, you know, a thing on a thing. Well, I'm the thing living on the thing, and I've got to pay to live on this thing. I can't do anything without paying to live on this thing. I have to be part of that system. So I choose.
The problem is that they can't maintain their own sustainability with their pension plans, with their vacation pay, with their health care, with their holidays.
It's not about that, though. I had a good friend of mine, and he was in the medical industry. And a guy that... was a couple of sort of levels below him. I couldn't tell you his position or whatever. With one of those guys, you know, he lived in a $4 million house where he could only really afford to live in a $2 million house. So when the financial crash or all that consolidation comes, he gets affected because basically, again, he can't do basic math. He can't figure out, well, my outgoings are more than my incomings, but because I can borrow some money, I'm having a wonderful life. I got no sympathy for those morons because they can't balance a checkbook. That's their own stupid fault. Well, what I come down to is those people that can balance a checkbook, can figure it out, and are going, oh, my God, why am I still not able to afford to live in a house, you know, and pass this house on to my family? Why have I now got to, you know, have they got to pay for the house that we've had in the family for years? It's like this Zuckerberg scam. Mark Zuckerberg basically just said he's never going to pay taxes again, and everyone missed it because they're not paying attention. He didn't donate the money to charity. He started a charity that he's the head of. So that means the charity can never be sued and never be taxed. So now he can hand any money over to anyone he wants inside of that charity, which is his family, if you look at the board of directors, so he can pass on any money to anybody without anyone being taxed. That's what happened. And everyone's going, oh, he gave money to charity. No, he didn't. Read the article. Pay attention.
Next, we've got up Wendy. Wendy, you wanted to add to Rob's comment?
Oh, yeah, I was very impressed. I realized some time ago the reason the house prices have skyrocketed is because people are so willing to go into debt. I mean, back in the 70s, I bought a little house. Admittedly, it was an old and not in very good shape, but it had an acre of land and water rights for $26,500. Then I parlayed that in. I sold it eventually for $90,000. I bought a house in West Jordan for $87,000. It had a $20,000 mortgage on it, and I took over that mortgage because I wanted to fix up the house. And I paid it off in 3 years, and I don't earn that much money. But I'm thinking, you should sacrifice big cars, vacations, trips, whatever, to get out of debt. Nothing's worth staying in debt. That is real bondage. You know, it's like Dave Ramsey says, live like nobody else, so one day you can live like nobody else. People put themselves into slavery, and that's why they allow the government to go into debt, because they have that mindset.
Makes sense, Wendy. Thank you very much for your call this morning.
But also, they're not trained any other way. They are trained to do that. They are trained to get the next. Because I always call it the shiny, shiny. You know, the guy was talking about the football or whatever it is. Everyone wants the new shiny, shiny. You see all the idiots run out with the forbidden fruit bite. You know, they call it the iPhone on the back of the phone, and everyone has to go out and get the new shiny, shiny. Why? It's still a phone. It does exactly what the last one did. It's still a TV. It's still
bigger.
It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter if it's a flat screen or if it's in HD or, well, just sort your life out. Your priorities are so far out of whack. You know, and I don't have sympathy for those people. I just have sympathy for the people that notice all of that stuff and still are having problems because of the way the system is set up.
You know, as a former banker, we also got involved in developing and building properties. And I've got to say the reality is that when I put together a budget to build a home, it comes out at $80 a square foot or $100 a square foot or whatever it is, depending upon the quality of the home. And that's what the subcontractors charge. And so if we want to have a home that is free or much less than it used to be, and if you want to own a home, you've either got to buy a home that's in foreclosure to get a cheaper price, or else you got to pay the cost to build the home. And so I have said on the air here before, when I was building some homes here in Utah and financing them, we had some people who were doing the sheetrock, and they were charging us so much per square foot for putting in the sheetrock in the home. And then as the housing boom increased, they went from $250 to $350 and finally ended up at $8 a square foot for putting the sheetrock in. And if you wanted to buy a home, then you had to pay for the labor of the people who are increasing their prices. After the crash in 2007-2008, those very same people came back to me. I couldn't use them. They were just too expensive. They came back and were willing to work at $3 a square foot again, and we had to tell them, hey, you know, you went up to $8 a square foot, and you made our homes unsellable. And I guess the thing I'm saying here is that, yes, there are real costs involved. And if you want a home and you've got to pay the fees to get your building permit and everything else, and yes, the government does raise the price of those fees, just like Rob said. The bottom line is, we're living in a society that if you don't follow the rules, they have the power. They have the police forces and everybody else to shut you down. And so it's not as easy to do, and I wonder what the solution is. How do we get past that? Yes, everyone can work for less. Everyone can charge less for their labor, but it's still all relevant because we then are paid less for our labor as well, and we don't make as much money on the sale of a home and whatever. What's the solution to this? We're in a quagmire of a society that is predetermined by local government and state government, county government, federal government, of the of how we fit into the puzzle, and how do you get out of that puzzle, as you suggested a few minutes ago? How do you extract yourself if you still want to live?
Stop playing the game. I don't recognize the government. I don't recognize the police force. Great. I don't know what game you're playing over there with whatever rules you're playing. But in this town, we don't recognize you. Go away. We don't recognize your game. Yes, great. Oh, you've got a court system. Great. So you've got a boat, because remember, a court is a boat in dry dock. That's what it is. It's trustee law. That's what it is. We don't play that game here. No, we're sovereign citizens. We've got an old sheriff. He's got a shotgun. You got a problem, he'll come shoot you. You know, that's pretty much how the only way out of it.
Han Solo, thank you so much for being on with us today once again. We're going to go to a commercial break. Please stay over with us, and we're going to be right back with Han Solo talking more about how to get out of the game. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're back with Han Solo. And Han, I got to tell you something, man. You get enough people to just walk away from the IRS, and there's really nothing they can do about it. I agree with you. But you get enough people to walk away from the crown of England back in the 1700s, and you'll bring the entire English Navy over to the coast of America.
No, they came over for money. That's what they came over. No other reason. You know, all they cared about was the money. They couldn't care where the people were. And then they realized how important it was to govern the country afterwards. But also, I mean, what are they going to do? Shoot everyone? And that's not going to happen. You know? And as Sun Tzu says, it's death by 1,000 paper cuts. If everyone just keeps filing, I mean, when was the last time you emailed the Supreme Court and say you don't recognize them and show the piece of paper that you signed that gives them power over you? I do that regularly. That's good fun. I emailed the Federal Reserve and asked them for $250 million. That's great fun when you send those emails off, just to mess with them, see what they say. And they said they, you know, I couldn't have the money because I wasn't a country. And I said, give me the money and I'll buy a country. I just have loads of fun with them. At the end of the day, I mean, like I was emailing the, I was playing with the CIA on their website just because they're idiots and, you know, they make it really hard to contact them. But they do have a part, if you want to bug the CIA, go to the part that's in Arabic where you can put, you know, where bombs are in Iraq. So because they pay Iraqis to, you know, grass up other Iraqis with bombs. But you can actually go on that part and then contact them. That's fun. Just bug them. I mean, at the end of the day, if there's a million people sending an email once a month saying, show me that you own me, show me that I need to do that law, show me the piece of paper that I signed to agree to it, well, you know what? They've got to answer that email because there's a million of them.
And that's one of the things that's always bothered me. They say we have the social contract that the government, the Constitution, that they abide by the Constitution, and we have to, you know, support our government because of that. But to me, they broke that social contract long ago. They violate our freedoms. They spy on us at whim, detain people in CIA black boxes. They violated that contract. So why am I obligated to abide by the social contract and they're not?
I wonder where the breaking point is with the majority of Americans. That's what my question is.
Well, you know, to be fair, though, I don't know if any honestly would really care. There is, I'd say, what now? How many people in America? 320 million?
370, I think.
Is it more now? Okay, yeah. So all you need is about a million of awake people, and you probably have that already, just to start bugging the hell out of them, because all of a sudden everybody else will come on board. And you know what? Half of them are still going to be watching the football on Sundays, and the other half are still going to be wondering who Kim Kardashian is going to marry next month. You know, but other than that, who cares about those people? We can go on our merry way and be happy, because if we don't make a change, no one else is going to.
Well, it's well known. It's well known that only 5% of the population in the colonial times were the cause of the Revolutionary War and the cause of freedom and the new nation. So even if you can get 5% of the people involved, and by the way, we've got how many hundreds of millions, 300 million, 300-something million people in the U.S., what if you get just 5% of that? That's a huge force, 15 million people or so.
Insane. I mean, that's insane. That's a massive number of people, you know?
Yeah. We have a caller here.
Brad, you're on with us live here.
Thank you very much. Good show. I wanted to put my 2 cents worth in, and it's regarding the fraud of our fractional reserve banking system. That is the crux of the problem. The whole point here is, hold on to your hat, there is no such thing as a mortgage loan or a loan, okay? Because you paid for that mortgage in full the very minute you signed the promissory note. And here's the proof. That bank securitizes that promissory note, and they take that money, then they monetize it, they lend it out another 9 times at a declining balance. And the key there is that they list that loan, quote unquote, in the bank's ledgers, not as a liability, but as an asset. Okay, now if you want further information, you can get online to AmericanFreePress.net. Of October 12th and 19th, they have an article about people demand bank reform. There's a group called American for Banking Reform. I've got their phone number, so write it down. They'll help anybody who's in trouble with their mortgage. They have successfully nullified over 750 mortgages and credit card accounts. The number, area code 717-503 6903. Their email is Hermitage Way, HermitageWay7 at cs.com.
Okay, give that phone number one more time.
717-503-6903.
Appreciate the call, Brad.
You betcha. Hey, heads up. We need to crash the system because they're crashing us. Okay, we're enslaved.
Yep, 100%.
Hey, Han, I'm hoping to actually change directions a little bit. You mentioned that there's the war coming and that you might even have some inside information on about this war. Could you maybe go into some details about that?
Yeah, well, quite frankly, I was told, okay, so take this with a grain of salt, because this is coming secondhand from the son of one of my insiders, okay? And he was, you know, very high up in the Illuminati, hated what he was doing, and basically tried to get himself out, and then he realized he couldn't get out, and that's when he basically stopped talking to his family and his sons and everybody, just because he knew how much trouble he was really in. So it's a secondhand message, basically, and what I hate with secondhand messages is you don't know exactly the words he used, and that's very important. So you don't know if you're getting the assumption back from what he thinks his dad is saying, if that makes sense, instead of actually what the words are. And he said that the war would last 7 years and it will come after the financial crisis or the financial collapse. But what is a financial crisis and what is a financial collapse? That's vague words. You know what I mean? That doesn't mean anything. Who has a financial collapse? Because Greece just had a financial collapse. You know? So who? What? And then that war would last for 7 years. And then after that 7 years, the entire purpose of the war is to eradicate religion. That is the purpose of the war.
War with whom?
Doesn't matter. Honestly, pick a country, because that, you know, he never said. And quite frankly, we can start a war with anyone. Just like you said, we went and bombed Iraq just for the fun of it. So we can start a war. I mean, literally, they're trying to start a war right now with Turkey and Russia. Why that's important is because Article 5 of NATO will get invoked, and instead of just fighting Turkey, he's fighting all of NATO now. So that's why the Turkey-Russia conflict is so important, you know, because if anyone attacks Turkey, that's attacking all of the NATO nations, and all of NATO must go to war with Russia now. Well, okay, apparently that's what will happen. Don't know, no idea. But what the whole goal and objective is to eradicate religion, so they can bring in their one world religion or their one world government and their one world order and move forward. And if we don't think that that's happening, have a look around you. Have a look at what the UN is. Have a look at what's really going on in the world. Because I tell you, in the last, I'd say, 4 years, that message is blatantly clear that, you know, there aren't any countries, there aren't any borders, and they are making this agenda openly known. I mean, if anyone studied the Georgia Guidestones, it's written there in stone, for crying out loud, what they're trying to do. So it doesn't mean that they'll achieve it.
No, the Georgia Guidestones, you're talking about reducing the population.
Mm-hmm, of course. That's also many things, you know. It's if you read, you know, that's the second one on there, but there's a couple of things that people are talking about on there. But at the end of the day, if you look at what's the current climate and you look at that they're picking off this Christian-Muslim battle, you can see what they're doing. You can see that, okay, that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to instigate a war between them, you know. Well, as soon as they do that, watch what they're going to do next. Then they're going to ostracize you having a religion, take all away your religious freedoms and, you know, and all those stuff that everyone fought 4 years ago. Well, that makes perfect sense to me, because that looks like what's happening. Is it going to happen? Don't know. I don't really worry about things like that. I've totally, you know, stopped worrying about things. There's just no need, because at the end of the day, they're going to do what they do. I'm going to do what I want to do. I don't want to play their game. I'm not going to go to war. Not interested.
No, and there's all sorts of talk right now about the fact that women are now being accepted into all roles in the military, which will lead to a draft that will include both males and females.
That's very interesting, because one of you just made a comment earlier on about the woman in the workplace, and all the feminists don't understand how detrimental they have been to society. And all the feminists are going to go, oh my God, how can you say that? Because you didn't understand how important the role of a woman being in the house was. The woman in the house is the heartbeat of the house. She's the sensible one. She's the one that keeps everything ticking over, doing the right thing. You take the woman out of the house and you're the man on his own, all hell's going to break loose. He's going to get mortgages, new cars, flash screen TVs, and all sorts of things, because that sensible loggerhead conversation over the dinner table is no longer there. And that's basically what's happened. The heartbeat of the house is gone. So when you have that, then you don't have a family unit. No family unit. It's really easy to control people when they're broken. and everyone's broken. Look around, you know, go out one night and go talk to somebody. They're all broken people nowadays. They're not whole people. They're not, you know, able to even, most of them, have a conversation or a relationship anymore. They just can't do it.
Can't argue with them there. I mean, it's widespread. It's widespread. You know, the antidepressant use, that drug here in the United States, is just a huge, huge seller. And yet there's something that just came out in the Journal of the American Medical Association. Everybody needs to understand this one. 87% increase in autism rates in children whose mothers, while they were pregnant, yep, were taking antidepressants. Have you heard that?
Oh, it doesn't surprise me in the slightest. Actually, that'll go on to, because I'll give my email address as well if anyone wants to contact me that's got any problems, because I've got friends that can help people with just about anything. But here's the biggest problem. You talk about drugs, okay? Well, drugs are bad. Well, why is everybody on drugs? So, on the one hand, they're saying, oh, you know, the war against drugs, don't do drugs, don't do drugs, but just take our drugs. Our drugs are good. I promise you our drugs are going to be okay. No, we haven't really had them out there for 10 years. There's more Prozac in the drinking water nowadays than there's ever been, because there's so many people on Prozac. Well, that has a massive effect on people's bodies, going through generation after generation. People forget that fluoride in their water has nothing to do with, it's a byproduct from the actual manufacturing industry. And it is the biggest thing, used in Prozac and rat poison. And everyone wants it in their water. Will you drink rat poison? Well, I wouldn't, but you are, because you've got fluoride in your water. And no one even bats an eyelid about it. You know? And they think you're crazy if you put a water filter on your house because you want clean water to drink.
It helps teeth. It helps teeth. Like what?
It gets weirder. So most of those metals actually isn't the drinking water you need to worry about. It's when you have a shower. I used to play a game with people, weigh yourself before you get in the shower and weigh yourself when you get out of the shower. You'll put on 2, maybe 3 pounds more, depending on your body mass, after you get out of the shower because of all the extra metals you've just absorbed from the water. And people go, no, they do it, and they look at you and go, oh, my God, this is insane. Like, yep, that's where you get most of the intake from, when you take a shower.
And then also, as you've got the steam and the chlorine that's in the water, you're breathing.
And it goes on, the cycle goes on.
At
the end of the day, no one's looking after your best interests, and people have to understand that. The medical profession, they're not after your best interests. You go, all they do is repeat what they've been taught, because if they don't repeat what they're taught, they won't get their qualification. End of. You know, they get that qualification, and they've got to toe the line and do what they're told. Otherwise, you know, they're thrown out. There's that practitioner, he's on cripplehealth.com, you know, the guy that cures people from being blind. He's been doing it for years and years, and he was thrown out of the medical industry for proving he was right, you know, and helping people. That's the world we live in. You prove you're right and help people, they'll ostracize you.
Well, if they don't shoot you in the chest first.
Oh, yeah. I'd love that day.
Those are alternative medicine folks who are dying off by the dozens now.
Yeah. They're self-suiciding themselves in forests. There's 9 that have gone, I believe. But, there's all sorts of technology out there. Like when I had cancer back in 2010 and got hooked up with my friend from NASA and cured it in no time at all. There's cures for absolutely everything out there. And if people don't know that, well, get educated. And they're more than welcome to email me if they've got any health problems or any health issues. And it's just hansolo73@gmail.com. And I can put them in the right direction and so they can talk to the right people. I think you can cure.
Can you give that one more time, please?
hansolo73@gmail.com. And quite frankly, there isn't a disease on the planet that can't be cured. So, if there's people out there that's worrying about autism or anything, it can be fixed. And literally to relatively no cost, because there is always a cost involved, but I would say pretty much you can cure everything for under $500. That's not a bad thing to do, is it really?
It's always amazed me how over the last almost 50 years now, the United States healthcare system has been at war with cancer, and still, after this much time, they only have 3 options for you. Well, we'll cut you, we'll poison you, or we'll burn you. Those are your 3 options. Thank you. Come again.
I'll take all 3, please, for Tom. It's just crazy. Yeah. The fact that no one even questions it.
Right.
You know, and again, it goes on like, so when I came back to the UK after being away for such a long time, all I see on TV is adverts for charities. And I'm just like going, hold on. You just did a comic relief Red Nose Day thing with all these celebrities come on. If you all took 1% of what all of you morons earned, you would have just donated about 16 to 17 times more than you've ever raised in the last 20 years for this charity. And you can, if you want to play their game and pay taxes, you can use that as tax deductible as well. But you don't. So don't come to me looking at my, you know, pathetic bank account looking for money when you guys can just cure it all in one go.
We've got Han Solo on the phone with us. And he's been with us for the first hour and almost the entire second hour. We're going to have another 20. Well, we're going to have 15 minutes after the next break, Han. So don't go anywhere, please.
No problem.
We're going to commercial break now. And folks, we'd love to talk to you and field your calls as well. If you want to call in, 801-254-5855 if you have a question for Han Solo. Unfortunately, Chewie isn't with him. But ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to K-Talk. This is Inside the News. It's 43 minutes after the hour. We have a few minutes left here with Han Solo. And John, you had a direction you wanted to take this.
Yeah, Han, if you wouldn't mind, I mean, we got have you on the air for just for a few more minutes. If you could kind of give us an outline of what's going to be happening over the next few years and maybe give us some more inside information that you've gained.
Well, I was actually just thinking, you mentioned that. I was just thinking about that, you know, when we were on that break. And I was just going, okay, well, because what I don't like doing is being wishy-washy and going, okay, this, because there's so many predictions out there. There's all, you know, everyone always saying this is coming along or that is coming along, and it just doesn't happen. So I always sort of try to steer clear from that. But to be fair, I honestly believe that we're coming up to this Third World War, this actual, you know, line of conflict. And it isn't just, you know, just a war, like a normal war that we're thinking about. I honestly believe this is the war that will change the actual person from being able to claim their sovereign, you know, sovereignty back. Because if you go through history and you look at everything, all they do is they take away information from people. And we are becoming more and more stupid as the days go by. Every generation, you know, when they go for, oh, the Library of Alexandria accidentally burned down. It didn't accidentally burn down. You eradicated all their knowledge, and that's what you did. And that's what's happening systematically, systematic, slowly control over the internet. I mean, pretty much, Google and Facebook run the internet. You know, that's pretty much what happens nowadays. So they're slowly chomping away and stopping you getting any access to any information that may enlighten yourself at any point. And anything that you do have doesn't help you anyway. It just puts you in a circle. And that's one of the other things that people do, especially in this sort of conspiracy world, is make you go in a circle. They put you in a little pattern, so you keep going around and you never actually find the answer to anything. All you do is find another layer. And they say, oh, you're going down further down the rabbit hole. No, you're not. You've just been lied to for 4 days and you didn't realize it. You know. And the biggest thing that people can do is actually get physical copies of stuff, knowledge, books, actually get hold of stuff, because if you don't, nobody else is going to. And that could be the best advice I could give to anybody.
So how much time do you think we have before they really try to make the internet a controlled, very controlled?
To be fair, I think it already is. I think the internet pretty much now, anything that's out there, I mean, I used to be able to get plans for, you know, about running your car on salt water. That was easy accessible. Now you have to dig for it. You know, it's still out there. You can still get the plans, so you can, you know, drive your car around on salt water. But now you have to actually hunt for it, and it takes you, you know, sometimes half an hour, sometimes 2 hours to find it where it was easy to find. And also, it depends on what country you're in. Since I've come back over to the UK from America, the UK is so much more censored than you can imagine on the internet. And I didn't realize that unless I'd lived outside the country for a long time. Something simple, when I listen to Coast, and when you search for that, it won't even come up. It literally changes. If I leave that search browser up, it will change. If I put the specific date in and what you know I want to watch, if that's something that they don't want you to listen to, that will not come up. It'll bring up like August 28th instead of November 28th. Or 5 years ago, when you put the date in exactly. And I'm seeing it more and more happen. Even one of the other things I noticed was happening the other day. I was doing searches on my iPad. I went from my iPad, turned on my computer. The searches that I did on my iPad were already on my computer. So, when you go on Google and you put that first letter in, it comes down. Not only were it already on it, it was already highlighted like I'd clicked on it. I hadn't even turned my computer on that day. So I think we're already past that stage of the control of the internet. Now it's just basically get as much information as you can so you know how to filter water yourself. You're prepared for any worst possible scenario, and that way you don't really care about anything anymore. What are they going to do to you at that point? You've got enough information to sustain yourself. What are you going to do? And now you're fine, and then stop worrying about it.
Do something
about it.
Han Solo, I just got a text. They said, did you say you can run your car on salt water? And do you run your car on salt water?
I don't have a car. I don't play that game.
Oh, okay.
I don't have a car. I got rid of my cars probably 4 years ago. People laughed at me and said, how did you get around North America without a car? I find a way. There's always someone going that way. That's okay.
Well, I guess I don't need to own a car as long as John picks me and Josh up for the show.
All right.
Yeah, but also, one of the main reasons I don't have a car as well is because I'm not in a location fixed yet. So when I decide to sit down in a proper location, I might do that, but not right now. The first thing I'll be doing on my car, is getting out those old plans of salt water and trying to run it. I mean, Fox News did a special in 1984 about running your car on salt water. It was on YouTube for the longest time. They did, there's a documentary out called Who Killed the Electric Car, which they did in 1992, where they had electric cars that were just out of this world. I think General Motors made them, and then they recalled them all. And these people that had, the consumers that had those cars, tracked their cars to somewhere in, I think it was Arizona, and they ended up getting in a helicopter and flying and looking at their cars because they weren't allowed them back. And it's one of the weirdest documentaries about how much technology is out there. And there isn't this alien technology like everyone talks about. We haven't even got into any of that stuff tonight, but how I know all about that. I mean, that just doesn't exist.
Well,
that's just another misleader.
Got some really bad news, and this is a little change of subject here to go along with what you're talking about. One of the biggest frauds, in my opinion, that most of the people in the United States truly believe is real is NASA. I think it's a complete fraud. And they just
wait until I tell you about that.
They just got $20 billion written into the 2016 fiscal year budget, way more than they requested. So,
one of my good friends, I've known for a very, very long
heck?
Time.
What in the heck are they doing?
Wait until I tell you this. One of my good friends I've known for a very, very long time. I've had many birthday parties with him. He's always been 70, by the way. I don't know how old he is now, because every birthday he's 70. He actually did the original models and designs for the original space shuttle before it went up, the actual metal space shuttle that they used in all the wind tunnels, and the different wing design that it had originally. So when you come to NASA, I know a lot, way too much about NASA than you can imagine. But it's not only that. Think of the way that everyone is brainwashed. You talk to anyone, and they all think that there's a secret hidden alien technology at Area 51.
Right.
And when they release this technology, we're all going to be saved. No, the only way we're going to save ourselves is if we stop the Federal Reserve doing what it's doing, because there isn't any secret technology. And you can know that right now. Politicians can't keep quiet who they're having sex with, and they want to put that stuff on Twitter. Do you really think that they could take this hidden secret technology away from you? There's a great guy called Douglas Dietrich who talks about what really happened at Roswell and what's really going on. Because I'll tell you right now, if we had that technology and anyone could do that, there'd be some idiot like me who would just go, right, sod it. I'm going to go show the public this and park it somewhere or do something retarded. And there isn't. It doesn't happen. And we used to play a game with all my, which we haven't got into, all my military connections and who my father is. debunk the UFO. And every time there's a UFO thing, we just basically point out, okay, so that's that airplane that they were testing over there. Okay, so that's that airplane that they were testing over there. And, I mean, there was things with contrails, with donut-shaped rounds when they were doing the mag pulse engines, and everyone knew what the mag pulse engine was, except for all the UFO people. You know, it's just like, come on, guys, pay attention.
Now, what do you think about chemtrails? Do you think they exist or not?
Oh, don't even get me started on that. Well, basically, when I did my, because I'm currently doing a physics degree, so I can argue, because if you don't have a piece of paper to argue with idiots, those idiots think they're right. They are completely real, and I'm not quite sure what they're used for, because all global warming is fake, absolutely 100% fake. And if you do a physics degree, the first thing they'll indoctrinate you is to global warming. When they explain to you that there's 284 particles of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere per million, and it's raised from 284 to 327 particles per million, and a cow fart is 4,000 particles, there's way more problems with cows farting than there is CO2 in the atmosphere. So the problem with contrails, though, I honestly think that's totally to do with weather modification. Because when you get into global warming, the biggest problem is water in the atmosphere. So if water's the biggest problem, that means it's not raining. So then when you look at all the wildlife and the stuff that was dying all over the planet, well, if you look at where that is, where that had heavy rainfall, basically, they are getting chemicals dumped down on those bees and all sorts of different things that isn't diluted by the normal percentages of water that it would be. So it's just getting massively dumped on by all these chemicals. So why are they holding that back? Why are they keeping the rain in the air to control the weather for this global warming agenda? You know, there's something going on there, unless they're going to tie that back into the sovereignty of people and say, well, your carbon footprint is too big, so you basically must live like a Chinese person and have, you know, this is the only amount of resources a person is allowed per lifetime, because they're going to kill the planet if they don't. So, you know, it might go full circle and tie it back to that. But contrails are totally chemical trails. I will not have anyone tell me they're not. I've grown up on Air Force bases all over the world. You know, chemtrails are 100% legitimate. And the difference is, when you really understand how a contrail works, is a contrail actually only happens on certain types of engines, because it's the actual airflow behind it that the engine heats up that makes, you know, makes the condensation. And without that, it doesn't work. So there's only a certain aircraft that works on to have that trail in the first place, and you can't make crisscrossy patterns all over the sky you know, with those jets. It's just not real. So it has to be something else. And they're chemical trails. You know, just admit it, people. Stop lying about it.
Thanks for being with us today, Han.
Sorry, I had to talk a little bit faster. Anyway, it's like 5 minutes left, so.
Yeah, we go to break here in just a couple minutes. I got to make some announcements for tomorrow's show, but very, very interesting. Thanks for coming on with us. Where are you headed next?
To be fair, my next adventure is I'm off, for anyone to know, because I'm off to China.
Nice.
Yeah, I'm going there because I have another agenda that I'm up to, because I'm off to go to Antarctica. I've got to do two more things. I've got to acquire a pilot's license, and then I'm off.
Off to the outside ring, are you? Good for you.
Yes, I'm off to go and prove some theories that I have, and the best way to do it is get off your ass and go and do it. Don't talk about it. Just go do it.
Right on. Well, I wish you all the best, and I hope to talk to you on the other side.
You take care, guys.
All right. Bye-bye. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that pretty much ends our show. I want to talk about tomorrow, because it's a really big deal. Here, for local Utahns, we are going to have a gubernatorial debate between Senator Jim DeBacchus and Jonathan Johnson, the former CEO of Overstock.com.
No, he's still the CEO. Current CEO.
Okay, he's current CEO, excuse me, but they're both going to be the governor of your state. So I suggest you talk to as many people as you can who are interested in who's going to be governor, and have them listen and call in and ask questions and be an active part of our show. Loads of questions we have to talk about with them. I don't think 2 hours is going to be enough. Governor Herbert has not responded to any requests to be on the show. But we've got a new phone system, Governor Herbert. I don't have any trouble answering calls anymore. It's okay now. You can come on. I don't think that's the reason he's shunning us. But anyway, two of the real contenders. I don't think Herbert's going to go in for a third term. We're going to have Jonathan Johnson and Jim DeBagas.
And that's at 8 o'clock.
And that starts at 8 o'clock. At 7?
Nope.
What, no, at 7, what are we doing tomorrow at 7?
We're going to solve all the world's problems
of
between
course.
7 and 8 before the debate.
Of course we will. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for being with us today. This is Josh, John, and Paul, and we are signing off. Anything else, guys?
Well, just do it as right. Remember who you are and return with honor.
And think twice when you send off those IRS papers. We'll see you tomorrow. And then we fly far away. Used to dream of outer space, but now they're laughing at the face, saying, wake up, you need to make money. Yeah. We used to play pretend, give each other different names. We would build a rocket ship and then we fly far away. Used to dream of outer space, but now they're laughing at the face, saying, wake up, you need to make money. Yeah. Wish we could turn back time.